maturing in character, maturing in responsibility, maturing in freedom, while yet protecting your partner, so that also your partner can grow in the same thing, and both of you grow together and your marriage grows together. They're about taking ownership of your life so that you are protected and you can love and protect your spouse without enabling or rescuing him. What do I mean by that? I take ownership of my life and protect myself while still loving my husband, even if they are doing something that is against our vision. I'm looking and he's doing something that is really not taking us where we want to be. But I can protect myself from the effect of that and still love and protect my spouse without enabling them to continue with that bad behavior, that bad attitude, that bad activity that is causing trouble. Or when they land in trouble, I don't rescue them from that trouble, but help them work into that. That comes in situations where your partner is probably in some form of addiction. You don't rescue them, but you love them and protect them enough as they work out their way out of the quagmire that they are in. Boundaries help us determine who is responsible for what, and therefore they help us to become the catalyst for change, not only for yourself, but for your spouse, so that they can be able to come out of that thing that you did not want to enable them for or rescue them for. So it's about now protecting yourself so that you can protect and love your neighbor. So remember, that's what we are saying, boundaries. You're not setting them for them. You're setting for him. You're setting them for yourself. You're not setting them for her. You're setting them for yourself. Boundaries also provide protection within which freedom will be exercised. So sometimes we feel very helpless because something is happening. Like, for example, if one partner is not practicing good financial stewardship, and you end up now being in debts that are all the time, or most of the time, you find that the auctioneers are at your door. Yeah. Sometimes you feel helpless, especially if you are the one without a job and the other person is the one earning. But when they earn, they always now push you to a point, do things that make sure that the finances are not used correctly, and you're always finding yourself in trouble. You may be feeling very helpless, but boundaries will help you protect yourself and realize what freedom you have within that situation. And then you exercise that freedom so that now recovery can be practiced, so that now you're both back on track towards your vision as a family. So boundaries is about ownership. That's what we are saying. So what are we owning? It's not about owning that car or that house. The boundaries we are talking about is not about owning that car or that house or that business or anything. No, we are talking about ownership of the things that pertain to your soul, the feelings, the attitudes, the behaviors, the choices, the limits, the desires, the thoughts, the values, the talents, and also owning that love. So we are talking about ownership. Boundaries will help us establish now ownership of that love, ownership of the feelings, the things that are within your soul, so that now we get to know. If there is trouble, like, for example, if there's now trouble with finances, what we are saying about, there may be some feelings expressed that are harmful to the marriage. There may be some attitudes that are being expressed. Of course, it has started with certain behaviors. That's where we have landed where we are. And maybe it has started with some desires that are landed where the family is, and now the relationship is straining. So now when you put those things, the feelings, the attitude, the behaviors, the desires, you put them on the table, then you sort out feelings belong to who, attitudes belong to who, behaviors belong to you, desires belong to who. Then now somebody can take responsibility for that. Now when you sort them out, even if the other person is not participating, you are able to take charge of what belongs to you. So if overspending of your partner is causing you catch some feelings, and those feelings are making things worse, or they are putting the relationship at jeopardy, or they are making that the intimacy within the relationship be affected, then you know these feelings belong to me and I have to deal with them so that now they do not contribute to this problem. If it is some choices that are being made because of the feeling, you're making some choices that are making the situation, you own those and then take responsibility and do something. Then now the other things that belong to the other to the other partner, if there are the behaviors and the desires and also choices, then you do not feel so helpless in terms of this thing is affecting me and I can do nothing. It's only my partner who can do anything about it. You are left with something that you do. And now when you're able to do something about the feeling and the attitude, then it becomes easier for you to communicate to the other person that now when this happens or I feel this when this happens, and then now the other person is left to know that yes, they need to own this for you to be able to work together. So it's about ownership and taking responsibility. That's what we are talking about. So what are the importance of boundaries? They help us to, number one, realize our freedom. Once again, that's what we have said. And maybe to emphasize this, let me give you now a small illustration. I will just use myself and my husband, and I'm not saying what I'm discussing is what he does. It's just an example I am giving. My husband is born again. He's in the house today. Help me appreciate him. He's always been very supportive, but I'm going to give this illustration using him and I. Now, if my husband smokes, and he's been a smoker even before we got married. I am giving an example. Please don't go writing a message there to say that my husband is a... Mm-mm. I'm just giving an example because I do not want to use your husband and I do not want to use names here. Such people will end up feeling like I was talking about them. I am just using that as an illustration. So supposing he smokes and I have a problem with smoke, like probably I am asthmatic. So every time he comes home, and takes his cigarette, then I have chest issues. And then we get a baby who also has chest issues. So every time he comes home, there will be sneezing, there will be need for inhalers, there will be a lot of discomfort. Yet, when we speak to him about it, he's like, this is my home, I can do whatever I need, I want to do. What will happen is, I will start catching some feelings, isn't it? I will feel like he doesn't care. I will feel like that it doesn't bother him that we get so sick and we always have to spend a lot of money to buy inhalers and things like that for me and the baby. I will feel like he doesn't care that our baby is also suffering from whatever. And then I might become resentful. Now, when I'm resentful, what happens is I will not be looking forward to him coming at home. Not because I hate him. I still love him. But because I hate what he does when he comes home. So every time he knocks at the door, number one, I'm not looking forward to opening the door for him. And number two, even when I start opening the door for him, I will open with an attitude. And I might look at him like, oh, it's you. Or I might just open the door and sit down and say, oh, here he comes again. Oh, here trouble begins. And he can see how I'm behaving. Yeah. So their attitudes, their feelings, their choices that I am making, and it is communicating to him something else. So he comes home a happy man. He's coming to his own home. He still wants to take his cigarette and relax and watch his movie and all that. But I have already caught my feelings. Yeah. And I am already behaving. So he feels disrespected in his own house and starts staying late. He wants to come home and find me asleep because he's not feeling welcome. Now, something else has added itself. He's made a choice to be coming home late, maybe to find us asleep. But it doesn't mean the feelings will not be there. So it has affected our intimacy. So what do I need to do? Yeah, I'm just using this as an example. Because it's beginning to affect our intimacy. Yes, I do get sick. Yes, the baby still gets sick. The problem is there. And yet the original problem is he smokes. If he was to stop smoking, then these problems would not be here. I will not go to him and start telling him, you must stop. No, I will take responsibility for what is mine. And these are the attitudes, the choices, the words that I make and all that, yeah, that are making things worse because our intimacy now has also started being affected and we are looking like now we are beginning to go in different. And when I take that, I take care of the problems that I have, then it opens a door for me to be able to communicate to him. And if I communicate to him in love, then he will see he will be able to see now how this thing affects us. He will not be on the defense anymore. And then now he can also make some choices. He can take responsibility of that which is his. And now it also makes me realize one thing, that if he's already addicted to cigarette, he has no control over that. So he needs my love and my understanding to be able to work through that. So it's not something that he will sit and decide, now tomorrow I'll not smoke because it's affecting my family. No, he'll have to work through that. And now, because we are communicating again, we have taken responsibility of the things that we need to take responsibility. We have taken ownership. We help each other go through it. So now, when we are working together, he can decide, like, fast, every time I feel like I need to smoke, I will be stepping outside. He's taking responsibility and the consequences. Being outside means he'll be out in the cold, and sometimes he might feel like smoking in the middle of the night. So going out there might be exposing him to certain risks, but he's willing to take that chance, because now we have communicated and seen. Then now it will help him now to have the will to fight the addiction and work towards getting rid of this of the smoking. So what are we saying here? That boundaries help us realize our freedom. Before, I was feeling helpless. Yes, I am in his house and he can do whatever he wants to do in his house. But then now when I realize and take responsibility of certain ownership of certain things, I realize, yes, he's in his house, but there's some things I'm responsible for and I can do something about. Yeah. Then number two, it helps us define the freedom we have or do not have. So what freedom do I have? I have freedom over what choices I make, attitudes, words, and behaviors. But I do not have control over whether he stops smoking or not. And now I also know or whether how he takes it when I speak to him, or I have no control of his choices and his attitude. I have no control, but I have freedom. And he also knows that he has freedom of the choices and things like that. But he also realizes now he does not have the ability to stop smoking by his own. So he also realizes the freedom he has and what he doesn't have. Yeah. And then because of that, we can be a catalyst for change. Now, he knows he's the one who needs to change, but my behavior will empower him to change. That's what we mean about a catalyst, adding fuel and being enabling the other person to change that harmful thing. Then boundaries also help us to know each other and truly love one another. Once we establish boundaries and we are able to communicate, I am able to apologize for my bad behavior, and he's able to see, like, oh, this thing was coming because this was coming and all that. You get to know each other and you truly love one another and help one another deal with that situation that probably has enslaved one of you or has enslaved both of you. And then importance of boundaries is they help you grow and develop in character and love. So that's why now the Lord will allow some of these things to come. That's why God will allow some of these things to come, because you also need to develop, to grow, to expand in your character and in your love. Because remember, very soon you're going to be, we are already responsible for our daughter, and we are going to be responsible for other children. Sons and daughters also will come who we need to teach character and love. So we will not be able to teach them character and love if we ourselves have not grown in character and in love. So within the boundaries, love grows. And as love grows, a spouse becomes more free from the things that enslave. And once they gain that freedom, they gain a greater sense of self-control. And when they gain a sense of self-control and responsibility, they become more loving. And the cycle begins all over again and again. So it doesn't mean that after we've dealt with this issue of smoking, something else will not come. Because tomorrow I'll be the one who is a problem. I am given a credit card and I start overspending. I am the one who goes shopping all the time and all that. So all the time we end up being in debt. Then he might feel helpless because I am the one who is spending. I have the credit card. And he feels like if he cancels the credit card, the family will suffer. Then he might feel helpless. But he still has to deal with it. Then now, when we go into the cycle of him dealing with what now is bringing problems in the family, again, the circle rebuilds itself. He takes responsibility, what is his. He makes me see my issues so that I deal with them. And in case now I am not willing to take care of them, that's where now limits come and consequences come. So he will let me now, if he talks to me and I'm not able to, and he says, now I'm not willing, I am going to cancel your the credit card. So he's willing to take that chance of the family or the daughter will suffer or the child will suffer. And he will also in some way suffer when the credit card is taken. But for me now to toe the line so that our vision grows, then he has to do the same. So that's the role of boundaries, that you take responsibility, and then now when consequences have to be, they are clearly communicated so that they are not there to punish you, but they are there for our well-being. So what are some examples of boundaries? We are saying we are talking about boundaries within the soul world, the world of souls or the relationship, yeah? So in the immaterial world of souls and relationship, boundaries will be a bit different from the material world. You know, a boundary in the material world, it will be a fence marking my territories from here to here. So I decide which kind of flowers I want to plant in my compound. I decide which grass I want, which trees I want to grow, and which kind of a house, which color I want to paint my house and things like that. But in the immaterial world, they're a bit different. But this one still have been supplied by God, because he is the one who breathed into Adam and into Eve to make them a living soul. And he's the one who also breathes into us to make a living soul. So he's the one who supplies us with those special boundaries for our interpersonal relationship and interpersonal realms. Boundary number one, an example of boundary number one is words. Yeah, we can use words. Yeah. Boundary number one is words or language. That's why we always emphasize, and many books, many secular books also emphasize on communication. We can use our words for good or for bad. But in the world of boundaries, we want to use our word to make sure that our rights are not trampled on. And we are not turned into a doormat. So when you feel helpless and you say nothing about it, that's when you feel like a doormat. But you can use your words and your languages to communicate. And we are going to now continue defining this a little bit more. Today, I just want to highlight that you can use words. As time goes by, we are going to study how do you use these words and how do you use language. Boundary number two is truth. Love and truth must exist together. Love and truth must exist together. We have read it in 1 John that we should love one another. And if we do not love, if we love, say we love God and we do not love one another, then we are lying. So love and truth go together. And God's truth forms the principle. God's truth and principles provide some of the boundaries. Remember the Ten Commandments? Commandment 1 to 4, relationship with God. 6 to 10, relationship with man and one another. So when we talk about do not lie, do not commit adultery, do not murder, those are things that are communicating that you love your neighbor. And so they form part of that truth also forms part of the boundaries that we are talking about. But also within marriage, when we are truthful with one another, when I communicate how I feel to my spouse, when I communicate in a loving manner, when we tell the truth in love concerning when our feelings are hurt or why we are behaving in a particular way, then it also becomes a boundary. Yeah, but remember, it is communicating in love. And that's why we are saying now some of these things are difficult, but not by might, not by power. Then the other one is consequences. Yeah, consequences. This is now when you, like, for example, now, in case my husband was not agreeable or was not cooperating when I told him about the smoking and affecting me, then I can put some limits and consequences in that. Now, if you will still continue smoking within the house, I might be forced to take the child and myself out of this environment. So you are communicating consequences. But because he was cooperative and he took the consequences, going out there in the night, exposing himself to the risk and all that, then again, so communicating the consequences becomes clear. So if they're not willing, then you can go the next step. The other boundary is emotional distancing. Emotional distances would work in an example, probably like if one of the spouses is having an extramarital affairs, and so there is a breach of trust. So sometimes when there's a breach of trust, you may emotionally distance yourself while you're sorting. Emotionally, so you're within the relationship, you're still communicating with each other, but you're not opening your soul completely for further hurt until the issue is addressed. If it is counseling you need, you go for counseling. If there are issues that needs to be sorted out, they are sorted out, but you have emotionally distanced until it's safe again to open yourself to that kind of hurt and breach of trust, of confidence again. Then the other one is physical distance. So sometimes physical distance may be the consequence that you put in that I will get myself out of this environment. And especially if there's physical abuse, like there's beating or the bodily harm, then sometimes you need to get yourself out of that environment. But sometimes physical distance is just you need time. You know, you may go visit a relative, go stay with your parents for two, not because you've walked out of the marriage, but because you need time to heal or time to think. Yeah, so physical distance. So physical distance can be all the way between one day or physical separation, depending on what you're dealing with. And then the other boundary is other people. Using other people now as a form of boundary. Like, for example, if you find that communicating to your husband is difficult because they always trivialize or they always do not take you seriously or their words continue hurting you, then you can do it in the middle. You can go to a counselor or to go to a pastor or go to a relative who will mediate the conversation so that you'll ensure that things are being communicated without the other person interrupting. Yeah, you may also now involve you might also need to involve maybe support groups. Or sometimes you may need to remove yourself and go to a shelter. You don't go to a relative, you go to a shelter, as I said, when life is threatened, yeah? And the other boundary is time. You just say, now we will not discuss this until maybe 2 weeks is over. Cut them out, and then now you come and revisit that issue. If finances are an issue and people are getting emotional and choices are being made that are not pro the vision or pro the family, then again you can say, now we will discuss the issue of finances on this particular date at this particular time, or we will be discussing them on this particular day slowly until it is resolved. So time is also a boundary, such that now whenever I broach that subject and it's not time, meaning the other person is not in the frame of mind to discuss such an issue, it will not be discussed. But when the time comes, both of you should be in the frame of mind. You should have prayed about it. You've already sorted out the emotion. You've taken care of the other, owned all the other things that go around it, the emotions, the choices, the talents, and the issues of love, so that now when you sit down, you can reason out together. So those are just a few boundaries, but there are many others. So probably you can seek out books that you can read more about that. But those are just examples for you to get what we are talking about, things that will facilitate love to grow. And so marriage, the relationship in marriage to grow, the marriage to grow, and finally the family to grow. Or if there is healing that needs to be done, it facilitates that. Now, we read Galatians 6. And Galatians 6, I just wanted to bring out now Paul's example of people who are in the school of hard knocks called Galatians. They've been born again. Remember, we talked about marriage being our marriage, working our marriages to be like the marriage between Christ and the church. So the church is a family, is the bride of Christ. And the church sometimes can be misled. The church sometimes can be in a quagmire. The church can sometimes make wrong choices that leads them into a wilderness. And that is the situation that the church in Galatia found itself in. They made wrong choices. They allowed the wrong teachers to come and teach them. And so they were misled. And so Paul was not very happy. It's good that you go and study that, because it actually defines our marriages. It defines our families and where we may be. And we may get a few pointers. Yeah. So at Galatians chapter 6 is the last chapter. So I'm looking from the back, going back to the front. So Paul now is telling Galatians how to treat each other with love as Christians when they sin against each other, or when one brother sins, how they ought to treat each other with love so that they can restore that person. Isn't that what we are supposed to do in marriages? Yes. We treat each other with love even when we have sinned or wronged one another, so that we still preserve not only that our Christian nature, but we also preserve ourselves within the kingdom. So that now, when you wrong me, I do not push you out of the kingdom or push myself out of the kingdom. I don't fall out of grace. I don't backslide. No. So as Christians in this school of hard knocks, Paul is just teaching us how we ought to treat each other with love. So the first boundary stick he's putting is love. Then he's saying that those who are truly godly are not proud of their accomplishment, but they humbly help others. What does it mean? If the other person is the one with a problem, let's say now the addiction, the smoking problem, I should not be proud that I do not smoke, that I do not have a problem. I should not be proud that I'm born again and so he's not born again. But I should help, be humble enough to help him. So he's telling us that we do not deal with one another with self-righteousness, self-centeredness, and selfishness. We deal with each other out of love because we are children of the same family. So in marriage, we are here to stay together because God says, let nobody put asunder what he has joined together. So we are here to stay together. So how do we go this journey together? So he says, pride is one thing that we should get out, and humility is one thing that we embrace. So in setting boundaries, again, humility is key. And he says something very interesting. Carrying each other's burden fulfills the law of Christ to love one another. So now here we have a person with a problem. And we know our problems do not come from God. They come from the enemy. So whatever it is, we help each other carry that burden. So I help my husband carry the burden of the addiction. He helps me carry the problem of overspending or not knowing how to financially manage myself until we stand together. We do not ignore the problem, or we do not say you sort yourself out or go out there after you've sorted yourself out, come back here. No, we go together, carry each other's burden. Then he says something also very interesting, that if believers carry their own load, they will have no occasion to treat one another with contempt. And that one, I agree totally. Remember, the first one was carrying a burden. A burden is something that is back-breaking, you know. It is something that you cannot let go on your own. You need help to release it. You need help. You know, it denotes some enslavement. You cannot get away from the burden until you have help. So because the burden is breaking your spouse's back, you help them carry it until it is offloaded their back. But the load is something you put yourself on. You put on yourself a load. So carrying your own load is what we are talking about. Taking responsibility of all these other things, that your burden has come, your spouse has a burden, but it is bringing loads within. So you carry your own load. So as the Bible says, that do not look at the splint in your brother's eye, but you see the log in your eye. So as you look at the things that may have caused your spouse to end up where they are, you also see the things that may be enabling them, and the things that you're feeling helpless about, and the things that are making the situation worse. So while you're working on those, it gives you no occasion to look at your spouse in contempt. So when I start realizing I'm disrespectful and start dealing with my disrespect, I actually stop noticing that he smokes, or he has a problem with smoking and he cannot stop on his own. Yeah, I start now looking at ways, how can we help each other while you're working this out? How can we prevent us suffering a little bit, all of us suffering out of it, or it making us worse? Because if you smoking is making us buy more and more medication, it's eating into our finances. So how do we help each other? So as long as I am dealing with my own loads, as long as I'm dealing with my emotions, my choices, I will not treat my husband with contempt, because I will see also the weaknesses that I have, and I'll be so very busy pleading with God to help me, asking the Holy Spirit to help me, such that now it is easier for me also to help him carry his burden and pray for him. Yeah. And he also tells us one thing, that we cannot mock the justice of God. So the minute I am self-righteous, the minute I am proud that I do not do certain things, when the justice of God comes, it will still see the things that I do, and the things, you know, the log in my eyes, he will see, and he might decide to ignore the splint in my spouse's eye and deal with the log in my eyes, and so he's just I will sow what I reap. In fact, that's what it says. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. What you sow is what you reap. So now this is where I am saying, if I sow love with my husband, when it comes time for me that now the issue is me, I will reap love from him. He'll help me walk through it. If it is now our children, we'll be able now to love them through their issues because we have learned that though God will deal with them, he'll also deal with us for our issues. So as we carry our own load, as we help each other carry burdens, and as we carry our own load, remember that God is not mocked. As you deal with your issues, do not be judging your spouse. Do not be judging the other person, thinking that they're the ones who will be judged by God when he comes. He will judge all of you. You for what you have sown, if you have sown love, you will reap love. But if you have sown hate, you know what? If you have sown strife, they say the Bible says, he who sows the wind, he will reap a whirlwind, because it is always multiplied. Yeah, you sow the wind, you reap a whirlwind. So whatever you sow into your partner's life, you reap multiplied. You reap multiplied. You sow hate, you reap multiplied. You sow disrespect, you reap multiplied. And so it goes again to tell us that if we live to please the Spirit, if we want to please the Spirit, we can only do it with the Spirit's power. So what are we saying? We are saying that if you remember, we had alluded to the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5:23-22. If you want to reap the fruits of the Spirit, then you need the Spirit's power. And that's why our topic today is not by might, not by power. We need the Holy Spirit to help us so that now we are able to set boundaries that are not harmful to the other person but are helpful to both of us. Yeah, that those who live to satisfy their own sinful nature, if I'm setting boundaries so that I can protect myself and put the other person at a disadvantage, then I'm going to harvest decay and death. But if I live by the Spirit and the power and the power of the Spirit, and I trust in God, I am going to reap eternal life. And what does eternal life mean? It will flow into other areas. Because what we learn when we grow in our character, when we grow in our freedom, then other areas benefit. And when other areas benefit, there is life in the family. Joy and peace begins to flow. Perseverance begins to flow. And therefore, our family will always be at a better place. And then he warns us about being tired. You know, sometimes you can get tired of rescuing your partner all the time. But we say these are cycles that you have to go through, and the love has to grow through cycles. So sometimes you may get tired that the drama is only coming from one person. We are being warned about getting tired. So sometimes you get tired and backslide and start living a sinful life. You decide, okay, now I'm done. I'll go and get myself another girlfriend or boyfriend who will be taking care of me in this area. No, we are being told, do not get tired. Do not give up on this and try to go and start another one, because the same cycles will still repeat in the other ones in any case. And then it also says, do not get tired and then become legalistic. You know, you decide to apply your own laws. And sometimes we do that and we start applying traditions that in my family, in my culture, women do not do this, men do not this. Now we get out of being the culture of Christianity, we want to go into the traditional culture of the world, which now makes even things more complicated and worse. Yeah. So do not get tired and slip away into those areas, but keep asking the Holy Spirit to take you through. And then he says that freedom in the Spirit compels us to do good to others in love. So once we realize our freedom in the Spirit, in that I am not helpless in dealing with this situation, because there is something in me that I can deal with it, and I'm not dealing with it on my own. I have the Holy Spirit to help me. So if I have an issue with anger and anger is contributing to this, the Holy Spirit is there to help me. I have freedom. The Holy Spirit is able to give me freedom from that end. Then it will help me do good and do good to others, and it will help me love the other person, because I know I am not as helpless and I have a helper. And then it says something very interesting, that doing good to those in the family of faith demonstrates God's faithfulness. Sometimes we assume that the family of faith is only in church. No, your family is also a family of faith. Aren't you born again? Yes. Don't you believe in Jesus? Yes. Aren't you called people of faith? Yes. Then your family is a family of faith. So when you do good to people within your family, I know we tend to judge our spouses very harshly. We can be very kind to people outside there, but when it comes to our family members, when it comes to our own children, we do not show them the same compassion. We do not show them the same forgiveness. We measure them by a higher standard of morals. But the Bible says, when you do good to those who are of the family of faith, we demonstrate God's faithfulness to his children. So how better to demonstrate God's faithfulness than demonstrating him to your husband or to your wife or to your children? And that's what now we are being told by Paul as he teaches the Galatians, this wife who has taken wrong turns and so ended up in a wilderness, or this family that has taken wrong advice and that has ended up in a wilderness. So now, going backwards now to Galatians chapter 5, where now Paul is describing the issues that are biting this family, he describes possible lifestyles out of what they had been taught. They had been taught, they had allowed a wrong lecturer into their house, and they had been taught something. And out of that, three possible lifestyles came from. They were children of God, they were a family of God, but they had allowed wrong teaching within them. They had taken a wrong turn. They are now in the wilderness, and now they have choices to make. And out of these choices, he's saying, you can take the choice of a life of legalism. Yeah, legalism, following the law, setting tradition, and then using that measuring point to, you know, like a stick to beat people's head. Because now they had been told, for God, for you to really be right with God, you not only get saved, but also get circumcised. And circumcision was of the law. Now, salvation is of the grace. So mixing the two. And you taking a legalistic, like what you're saying, following traditions, saying that now I am a man, I'm from this tribe, and from this tribe, our cultural norms are like this. You can decide to follow that. It robs us of your Christian liberty and the freedom to enjoy what the Holy Spirit can do in your marriage. Because now you're following traditions, then the judge of the situation is always at the society. It also prevents growth, because you cannot grow now in character, you cannot grow in the freedom and in liberty unless the Holy Spirit helps you. And it promotes error. Because if there is an error that the culture is promoting, it continues. And then we have the life of license. The life of license is where you decide, now Christianity has made me free, so I can behave the way I want. That now they take it as a liberty to do what they want to do. This perverts your calling, and it also promotes sin. Because now you say that you've been forgiven by grace, so whatever you do is already forgiven. God, Christ forgave your sins, past, present, and future. Then you still start doing whatever you want. Then you will still end up being in sin, because you are encouraging the flesh to be the one that is taking over. And then number three, you can live the life of love. And that's what now we are advocating here, where you live by the law of love. Because though Christ came to abolish the law, He condensed the law into one: love God, love self, and love your neighbor. So we still live by the law, but it's the law of love. And we are exercising this freedom in love. When you exercise this freedom in love now, the license that you have been given, and you exercise it in love, then you know there are some things that you will do that will harm your partner more or mess the family more. Then you will not practice that. So the life of love is about loving and serving your partner and serving your family. And our lawfully free life will not lead to moral ruin, because you are having the Spirit to guide you. The Spirit now will work on your consciences. He will be telling you where you're going wrong. And then the Holy Spirit also gives you the will to follow the will of God. Now, when you are operating through that, the boundaries you set will be to help you and to help your partner grow, and also the family to grow. And he's now telling us, when we live the life of the Spirit versus the law, the reason why we need to live the life of the Spirit versus the law is we cannot simply decide to keep the law and not sin. We cannot simply. We have no control over that. We have no power over that. Why? Because our flesh also wants, is always at war against the Spirit of God. We were born in the school of hard knock with a sinful nature, and that flesh will always want to fight with the Spirit of God. So the answer is not our own human effort. The answer is living by God's Spirit. Because keeping the law just makes you now become more aware of how sinful you are. If you try by your human effort, you're already enslaved, so you cannot free yourself from that, from that bondage. Only Christ can free you from that bondage. Only the Spirit of God can free you from that bondage. So that's why now Paul is telling us that we should live by the Spirit of God and the desire to please God. And therefore, living by the Spirit of God means observing a higher ethical standard so you cannot slide into moral ruin. Yeah, and it will be a higher ethical standard than can be achieved by the law, because the law just shows you you've crossed the boundary, but it has no ability to pull you back so that you can align yourself. But the Holy Spirit has that. So we are going to close at that point so that now next time we will talk about now setting boundaries and taking examples. We will look at the laws of boundaries and how we can apply them in our lives. But today I needed us to understand what boundaries are all about. And you cannot set them without the Holy Spirit. And if you set them without the Holy Spirit, they will always be meant to hurt the other person. So I hope you have learned something today and that you're going to apply. I ask that you rewatch this on your own time, learn a few things. Write your own notes, write me questions so that now I know in future what I'll be addressing or what you did not understand. And I, as I said, like our page, share with others and invite others next time. So we are going to meet here next Sunday at 3:30. Today we started at 4 and we apologize for that, at 3:30 to 4:30 via Facebook Live or YouTube Live. And may God bless you and may God help you as even you ponder this, and may the Holy Spirit guide you and lead you so that you can heal, protect, promote love within your family. So let us pray together. Father, we thank you, we worship you, we exalt you, we magnify you, Jehovah God. Indeed, you are good and you are merciful and kind to us. And indeed, you have given us everything we need to live a godly life, O Jehovah God. We pray that, King of all glory, you will help us. Help us to appropriate that you have given us. Help us to appropriate the blood of Jesus Christ to bring healing and to bring restoration and to bring freedom where freedom is needed. Help us to appropriate the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, Jehovah God, to overcome the weakness of the flesh and to bear good fruit and the fruit of the Spirit within our lives, that our marriages may heal, O King of all glory. We pray that, Jehovah God, the fruit of the Holy Spirit will begin manifesting in our lives in a powerful new way, O King of all glory. That, Jehovah God, we may not only be good examples to others, Almighty Father, but as you repair us, Almighty Father, we may bring glory to you, Almighty Father, showing that, Jehovah God, that you are a good father to your children, and you have taught us also to be good children and to be also good helpers to others, O King of all glory. So help us, Jehovah God. We know we cannot do it by ourselves, and that's why we come to you, because we know it's not by might, not by power, but by the Holy Spirit, that you will restore us and make us what we ought to be, to the glory and to the honor of your holy name. We worship you, we honor you, we magnify you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen and amen. Thank you for being with us until the end, and thank you. May God bless you. See you next time. I love you, and Jesus loves you more.